All right, let's bring our panel into the conversation now. Former State Party Chairman for the Indiana Democrats, Robin Winston. 2016 Vice Chair for the Indiana Trump Campaign, Tony Samuel. Democratic strategist, Laura Beck. And former GOP lawmaker, Mike Murphy. So much to talk about this week. We're going to start at the State House. Mike, you served with Speaker Bosma in the General Assembly. What do you make of this news this week?
Well, I think it was a good time for him. He's been there 34 years. As he will tell you, he accomplished all of his checklist. I think he has been the best speaker of the modern era, much more professional in the process. He improved everything about how legislation is handled, from the calendar to the way it moves through. And I think it's kudos to him.
A lot of talk about potentially State Rep Todd Houston as a potential replacement. How do things change at the State House moving forward after Speaker Bosma?
I think John Gregg might, think that maybe, hard to believe that you think he wasn't professional.
I serve with John Gregg. There's nobody funnier than John Gregg, and nobody I'd rather have a beer with, but he pales in comparison.
Going to that district, let's just talk real quickly about that district. I think what was interesting is that the district that Representative Bosma, the speaker, served in, has really changed in the last 2 years. It's gone 10 points from Republican to Democrat between 2016 and 2018. Speaker Bosma did do a very good job at keeping his caucus together, and I think whoever comes in is going to have a tough time doing that because they won't have the relationships and they may not have the standing that he had and had built up over time.
So, yeah, we'll see who runs in that district as well. Tony,
exactly.
You also worked with Speaker Bosma at the State House.
I did, and I'm grateful for that opportunity from late 2001 to late 2007, almost 6 years. I was his communications director for him and for the caucus, and a great experience, like Mike said. I agree with everything that Mike pointed out, but also Speaker Bosma was a great leader for the state, but also for that caucus, as you've said, and a visionary. And he always had a bold agenda, which carried the state from the Democrat leadership in the governor's office to Republican leadership that got a lot done. His agenda was always called the boldest agenda of a legislative leader. And he did things like create the Indiana Economic Development Corporation, government efficiency, a lot that he doesn't get enough credit for, but he was a great visionary as a leader, and he's a great guy, 34 years. Speculation has been there maybe it was time for him to retire. Like Mike said, he's checked off all the boxes.
He faced a lot of scrutiny last year, did face an ethics complaint that was eventually dismissed. Do you think that factors into a decision like this at all?
Well, he only won Marion County by 17 votes. He was saved by Fortville and places in other parts of his district. So that politically weighs on you. And it probably, if you're bringing it up a year in advance, it's going to be brought up. It would have been brought up again. The real test is, what does he do now as kind of this resident speaker? Does he really push the agenda that 15,000 people came to see, which also he announced on that same day? And if that's the case, then that'd make a legacy that backs up what Mike said.
Well, let's talk about that. Red for Ed. What about the impact of the teachers there, thousands of them, this past week at the State House? Does this now become a political movement in 2020? We did see Democrats this week putting out a statement trying to seize on the fact that Governor Holcomb was out of town when this happened at a fundraiser for the Republican Governors Association. State Party Chair John Zodi said, "I'm certain Governor Holcomb heard Indiana educators loud and clear. The governor may be able to duck educators today, but can't outrun them at the ballot box next November." What's your response to that? And what
first of all, John Zodi is a nice guy. He's hilariously entertaining. But the fact is, the RGA was scheduled nearly a year in advance, and Holcomb would have been there
regardless.
Or absent some major natural disaster or something. The fact is that the transition is going to be smooth. We are 99% sure it's going to be Todd Houston. I talked to legislators just two nights ago, and they looked at me and said, "We all know who it's going to be. We're all behind Todd Houston." And so what Bosma has set up is an apprenticeship over the next 4 or 5 months. And so he will continue to have his influence, not only next session, but frankly, because of the person he chose beyond that as well.
But on this education issue, 2020.
I love how, you can shift from, stop talking about education, because it's not good for your party.
You saw what happened,
and then immediately shift into
John Zodi just got me going, I guess.
I guess so. I mean, let's talk about education. I do think that this is going to be an issue in 2020. I think anybody who has kids in school can attest that state education policy in Indiana is completely dysfunctional. The fact that the teachers and their supporters, their family members, all came to rally, they're not coming from Democrat districts. They're coming from Republican districts all over the state. And I think if the Republicans sleep on this, they're going to miss it.
It became a big issue, no doubt, in the Kentucky governor's race. There were a lot of other issues
there,
though. Let's also talk about the impeachment hearings. Pretty explosive testimony this week from Gordon Sondland, who said there was a quid pro quo and also said that he told Vice President Pence about his concerns, though the VP's office pushed back on that assertion. What about everything we saw this weekend and potentially the vice president's role?
Well, when we first talked about this and Tony was on the show, we said it was early on. Let's see what happens. Now we're seeing what's happening. These are Trump appointees sitting in front of a panel saying there absolutely was a quid pro quo. Six people have gone to jail. Two dudes tried to escape and not come back, and they got caught at the airport. I mean, come on. It doesn't take much to put the linkage together to see what's going on here, Dan.
Tony, I know you're chopping at the bit.
Yeah, I am. Most of these diplomats, bureaucrats that testified were not Trump appointees. They were Obama appointees. I liken it to any organization, any business. You get somebody new in there that you don't like their style, and then you're ready to pounce and twist things and turn things and exaggerate things. And that's what's happened here. None of them, Gordon Sondland, presumed this, presumed that. It's all hearsay. There are no facts pointed at any crime, and the tables are going to turn because of Michael Horowitz, the Inspector General's investigation is finally concluding, and you'll see the tables turn on what started all this, and it'll show that Trump was concerned about 2016 abuse, corruption by Ukraine, not 2020.
We're going to talk more about that on our podcast. Also have to mention a number of Democratic mayors from Indiana in the news this week for very different reasons. Of course, Mayor Pete Buttigieg taking part in the latest Democratic debate, facing more scrutiny now, too, as the new frontrunner in Iowa. Meantime, in Indianapolis, Democratic Mayor Joe Hogsett threatening to veto a proposal from councilors in his own party to give themselves a pay raise. In the new year, Democrats will hold a veto-proof 20-5 majority. Meantime, the mayor of Muncie now facing charges, arrested this week on public corruption charges, part of an FBI investigation dating back to 2014. Also this week, an arrest warrant issued for the mayor of Michigan City, who's been charged with several counts of intimidation and one count of official misconduct. Don't have a lot of time left. We'll talk about it more on our podcast. Your reaction to some of that this
Both
week.
Indicted mayors, Democrats, surprise, surprise. Hogsett is almost Republican. He's so cheap, and I think he's smart to veto any kind of a pay raise ordinance. And as far as Buttigieg, God bless him. He seems to be doing well right now.
He really summed that up quickly.
I'm just sorry. I can't even respond at this point. I mean, I'm not surprised that Mayor Pete is doing well in Iowa. I think his Midwestern approach translates well there.
We're going to talk more about Mayor Pete coming up next and have a recap of this week's Democratic presidential debate. Stick around. We'll be right back after this.